Good morning. These are your announcements for April 3rd. Save the day for Mega Kids Camp, taking place July 25th through the 28th at Century High School. Early bird registration has started. To sign up, visit the church website and click Heart of a Champion. Spring Connect groups are right around the corner. To see what is being offered this April, check out the brochure that was recently delivered to your homes or visit evangelum.org, where you can also sign up. Evangel's Easter egg hunt for grades 5 and below is coming Saturday, April 16th, from 9 to 11. Thought I had that. This event is for Evangel family and friends only. Pizza and pop will be served. To sign up for either of these events or both, go to Evangel's website, scroll down, and click Easter egg hunt. And finally, join us as we continue to learn about the five means of grace this Lenten season. We have one more noon Lenten service on Wednesday, April 6th. Pastor Mark will talk about communion and fellowship. Those are your announcements. Now let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Hey, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Good News Worship Service here at Evangel United Methodist Church on this beautiful first Sunday in April, and this also this Communion Sunday. We're so glad that many of you are here in our sanctuary with us. Thank you for being here, and we're also just as happy that many of you are also worshiping online this morning. Welcome to you as well. As we come to our worship today, everyone, I think it's good to remind ourselves that we should just not be coming here to go through the motions, because Jesus, the one who we worship today, is our defender and our provider and our protector and our redeemer and our waymaker and our wisdom giver and our good shepherd and our savior, and he is our king. Year after year, day after day, moment after moment, Jesus is doing great things in our lives. So would you please stand now? Would you please stand as we prepare to worship our King and Lord Savior Jesus? He is our hero who has conquered the grave. Let's worship.
Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the
Jesus, you are the God of great things. You are the God who does the impossible. You are the God who we worship today and who we come forth this morning to lay our lives down before you, casting our crowns at your feet, O God. We worship you. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we do indeed intend and desire to lay ourselves down before you this morning, to let go of ourselves as we lean into you, so our souls would be ignited in worship this morning, so that our hands would be ready to serve, so that our hearts would burst forth in praise. Jesus, we want to love you extravagantly this morning, to pour our hearts into your heart, to bless you as you have blessed us in any way that we can, to lay ourselves down this morning, Lord, so that you would be lifted up. We don't want to hold back this morning, Lord. Instead, Jesus, we want to love you with an extravagant, never-ending, overflowing, unyielding, passionate kind of love. So today, Lord Jesus, we come bringing what is most precious to us, our time and our treasures and our songs and our very souls, and we give them up to you. For we know that you have given us all of yourselves. You've given everything when you took the cross for us. You gave us your best when we were at our worst, demonstrating your love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, you died for us. So today, Lord, we acknowledge our sin and we seek forgiveness as we also lay ourselves down, pouring the very, very best of ourselves into worshiping you, and doing our best to be your hands and feet, building your kingdom here on earth as we follow you all the rest of our days. Jesus, it is in your name we pray. Besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple.
I will give to you my everything. bring, I will give to you my everything. All I am and all I have to bring, I will give to you my everything.
And I will follow my heart surrender, my Jesus, I am yours.
I will give to you my everything.
And I will follow my life in your hands, my Jesus, I am yours.
I will give to you my everything.
And I will follow.
All I am and all I have to bring, I will give to you my everything. All I am and all I have to bring.
Presence and worship this morning. There we go. The mic is on. As you entered the sanctuary today, if you are with us in person this morning in worship, you should have received one of our prepackaged communion elements. If you haven't used these before, there are two coverings on them, a very thin cellophane covering on top, covering up a wafer, and then a heavier cellophane cover covering up the cup itself, covering up the juice. Let me ask you to hold those for just a few moments in our service this morning. The scriptures tell us that on the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he gave himself up for us, and he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And will you pray with me this morning? Pour out your Holy Spirit on each one of us gathered here, O God, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And again, I'd like to invite you to take the prepackaged communion elements. If you did not receive one, if you'd raise your hand real quickly, the ushers will make sure that you are given one. Please go ahead and remove the top upper layer of cellophane, and you may receive the bread. And again, for those of you who are with us in person, if you'll open up the second layer of cellophane carefully so that you do not spill, you may receive the cup. And let us pray together. Oh God, once again this morning we pause in amazement at this incredible gift that you have blessed us with, that you have stepped out of the wonder and glory of heaven to put on human flesh, to become one of us and one with us, to take our sins upon yourself, a reminder of this Lenten season, of the journey that we travel through, that we might be made new as we run back into your arms. Bless us with your presence this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, we'd like to dismiss our teachers and our Sunday school students to their Sunday school classes. If you are worshiping with us in person, we'd like to take just a few moments and fill out the attendance cards that are found inside your worship bulletins this morning. We'd invite you to leave those in the baskets by each of the exits as you depart later on in the service this morning. That is the easiest way for us to keep track of those who are worshiping with us at this time. This is that time in our service, and again, we normally receive our offering, and we're not yet passing the offering plates. Again, thank you very much for those of you who are using those baskets to drop your gifts in when you depart later on in the service. If you are worshiping with us online this morning, the easiest way to support Evangel's ongoing ministry is simply to open the camera app on your smartphone, scan the QR code that's currently on your screen, and that will take you to a secure giving page on our website. There are also instructions on that slide on a couple of different ways that you can give to Evangel Church. As we prepare to return our gifts to the Lord, will you pray with me this morning? Well, God, you are the faithful giver of all of life, and you have done great things for us. In the life and teaching of your Son Jesus, you welcome us into your heart. Help us open our hearts unto others that we may be ever more willing to offer our hospitality, our support, and even our material resources wherever they are needed. Bless these offerings in your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And as we allow those who are worshiping online a chance to return their tithes and their offerings to the Lord, our band has another number to share with you.
What have I
in
blessing in you. As the heaven holds the skies, it's your hand that holds my life, and your love will lead me on when all else is gone.
And amen. And this morning, Pastor Susie has our gospel reading for us.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from John 12, verses 1 through 8. Jesus is anointed at Bethany. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume, and poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of Jesus' disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth about a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As the keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put in it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And amen. Thank you, Susie. Calvin Trillin is a journalist who began writing a weekly humor column for The Nation magazine back in 1990. He's 86 years old now, and so he's mostly retired, although he does continue to contribute comic verse to that periodical even today. In the past, many of his articles were often about real news stories that included elements that just gave him reason to pause. And several years ago, one such story was about a New York City man who'd been kidnapped and held for ransom. To be more precise, the kidnappers were demanding a ransom of $100,000 to return him safe and sound. Now, again, Trillin was a humorist, and kidnapping isn't particularly funny. So let me just say right up front that the story did have a happy ending. A ransom was paid. The man was returned home unharmed. More than that, the money was recovered, and the kidnappers were caught and sent to jail. And so if it had to happen, it was probably the best possible scenario, at least as the story came to a conclusion. But this was what Trillin found somewhat amusing and ultimately chose to write about. Though the kidnappers had originally demanded $100,000 to release the man, his wife had talked them down to $30,000. And so in his column, Trillin tried to imagine what the negotiations must have been like. And he had the wife saying something like this, $100,000 for that old guy? You've got to be crazy. I mean, just look at him. Look at that gut. You want $100,000 for that? You've got to be kidding. Give me a break here. $30,000 is my top offer. And I doubt that we can even begin to imagine the relief that the husband probably felt upon his release. But don't you just, you know, kind of wonder what happened when he got home and found out that his wife got him back for a discount? And more than that, that she had insisted upon it? Because most of us want to know that we're valued, that we're important to others, that someone might give extravagantly for us. Most of you are aware that before coming to Evangel, we were serving out west in Wyoming, actually west central Wyoming, in a city that was completely surrounded by the Wind River Indian Reservation. And if you ever traveled out that way, perhaps to visit Yellowstone National Park or maybe the Grand Tetons, you know that the state has a lot more scenery than people. In fact, while Wyoming is the 10th largest state by area, by landmass, it's also the least populous and the least densely populated state in the lower 48, with a population somewhere between 500,000 and 600,000 people. It really varies depending upon how the energy market is. If gas prices are up, then the population grows as people flood back in to work on some of the oil fields and things like that. So they're probably doing pretty well right now. But because the population is so sparse, most of the state's hospitals lack any kind of specialist. So that if you had a serious medical event, you know, like maybe a hangnail, you know, most small town hospitals basically served as a triage stop before shipping you off somewhere else that was generally a pretty far distance away. And so, for instance, from where we were at in Riverton, it was a two-hour trip by car to the Wyoming Medical Center in Casper. It was a four-hour trip up north and east to Billings, Montana. It was nearly 5 hours to Salt Lake City, Utah, and it was 5.5 hours to Denver, Colorado. Those were the primary venues, the primary sites that someone might be life-flighted to. And quite frankly, in the winter, there was no guarantee that the only highways leading to those larger communities would even be open. Highway 80 out there in particular can be closed sometimes for several days in a row when the snow falls. That meant that most patients who were shipped out after being triaged in a local emergency room were shipped out by medevac, by air ambulance services using helicopters that were also pretty costly. In 2020, the nationwide average cost was over $30,000 for a flight, and the costs weren't always covered by your medical insurance policies. And so many residents out there still purchase a separate insurance policy from the medevac company itself that covers the cost of such a flight. And because Susan had moved out west ahead of me, when she told me about the service, she also mentioned that she'd recently purchased one of those policies. And she said that she wanted me to know that the cost of such a flight would be covered if she needed one, so that if she ever did need to take a flight like that, I wouldn't be doing a mental, you know, cost-benefit analysis before deciding whether or not to call for the chopper. Now, she had a smile on her face when she shared that with me. But most of us would never even want to imagine that our loved ones would hesitate before making such a call. Because most of us want to know that we are valued, that we're important to others, that someone might give extravagantly for us. That may also explain why one of our most popular Christmas stories is The Gift of the Magi by O. Henry. And you probably remember it. I know, you know, I read it and learned about it in school. It's about a young married couple and how they deal with the challenge of buying Christmas gifts for each other when they have very little money when their first Christmas together. The couple are Mr. James Dillingham Young, Jim, and his wife Della. They're living in a modest flat. Each actually has only one possession in which they take pride. Della's is her beautiful, long, flowing hair, reaching down almost to her knees. And Jim's is a shiny gold watch, which had belonged first to his father and to his grandfather before him. And so on this first Christmas Eve, with only $1.87 in hand and desperate to find a perfect gift for Jim, Della decides to sell her hair for $20. And eventually she finds a platinum fob chain for Jim's watch for $21. Having found what she knew had to be just the perfect gift, she runs home and she begins to prepare dinner with the 87 cents that she has left. Remember, again, this is a different time. When Jim comes home and walks in the door, he looks at Della with a strange expression on his face, and Della quickly explains that she had sold her hair to buy him his Christmas present. At that, Jim gives Della her present, and it turns out to be, of course, an assortment of expensive hair accessories referred to in the story as the combs, which they both realize, of course, are useless now that her hair is so short. In turn, Della gives Jim the chain that she'd bought for him. And Jim shares that he has sold his watch to get the money to buy the combs. Although Jim and Della are now left with gifts that neither of them can actually use, they also realize how much each one has sacrificed out of love for the other and how priceless that love really is. We love that tale because it's a story of extravagant giving. And most of us want to know that we are valued like that, that we are important to others, that someone might give extravagantly for us as well. And that's why, that's what Mary does in this encounter in John chapter 12. John tells us that this event occurs and with another Passover drawing near. There's actually three Passovers recorded in John's gospel, which is why we have come to believe that Jesus' earthly ministry probably spanned 3 to 3.5 years. In fact, this Passover now is only 6 days away. And Jesus is at Bethany, a few miles from Jerusalem, and he's at the home of Martha and Mary, where a dinner is being given in Jesus' honor. As we might expect, Martha is serving. And as we also might expect, at some point during the evening, Mary engages in behavior that must have raised the eyebrows of nearly everyone present. Taking a pound of costly pure nard, and the Greek word that's used here actually referred to a Roman pound, which would have been a weight of about 12 ounces, Mary uses it to anoint Jesus' feet. And John's gospel doesn't begin to capture the scandal that's contained in Mary's actions. She is a single woman who not only touches an adult man whom she is not related to, she lets down her hair in order to use it as a cleaning rag, mopping up the nard that she has poured on his feet. And in that culture, in that time and place, letting down your hair and sharing physical touch were meant solely to occur within the confines of marriage. Leave it to Judas to point out for us that the pure nard that Mary anointed Jesus with would have brought 300 denarii on the market, or almost a year's worth of wages, as the NIV translates that information for us. When we were in college and talking about getting married, would-be grooms were often counseled to spend 2 to 3 months' worth of salary on an engagement ring. But the nard that Mary uses on Jesus cost several times that amount. More than that, some commentators believe that this pure nard, this costly perfume, may have actually been a part of Mary's wedding dowry, noting that an unmarried woman would oftentimes wear it in a small container around her neck, and she has gifted this to Jesus. And so Jesus silences his disciple Judas, rebuking him, explaining that it was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. And that's an appropriate topic, again, as we make our journey through Lent. This is a passage, at least in part, acknowledging Jesus' impending death. But I want to wrestle with a different question this morning and ask why Mary chooses to perform such an extravagant act. And I suppose that there are a number of answers that we might put forward. We could suggest that it's simply because they have a special bond that they have developed over the years. It's clear that Mary is a part of a group that's been accompanying Jesus and helping him and supporting his ministry. They have met up at a variety of times as she supported that ongoing ministry and welcomed him and his disciples into her home. If we looked at the previous chapter in John's gospel in the context and timeline of the gospel, there's another reason given to us. In John chapter 11, we learn that Jesus has raised their brother Lazarus from the dead. He's been in the tomb for 4 days, and as Jesus returns, he has called him out and brought him back to newness of life, restoring him to Mary and to Martha, to the two girls. Another possibility, and this may be even more likely, is a key that's offered to us in Luke's gospel, in Luke chapter 8, beginning in verses 1 and 2, where Luke begins that chapter this way: "After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases, Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means." And so it's possible that Mary offers this extravagant gift as an act of gratitude for all that Jesus has done for her. Compelled by love for the one who had rescued her life from the living hell that she had perhaps helped make it, she offers to Jesus the most extravagant gift that is at her disposal. In 2004, Mel Gibson released his controversial movie, The Passion of the Christ. In spite of the movie's gruesome violence, or maybe even because of it, I encouraged folks at the time to see it in the hopes that we would all be reminded of the terrible cost of our sin. Many who went to see it, in fact, testified that they were affected profoundly by the film. Indeed, after watching the movie, one young man confessed to a murder that he had committed. The film had moved him so deeply. But if God suddenly revealed to you the magnitude of your sin, and then showed you the agony that his son endured on the cross, dying for that sin, what gift would you bring to the altar to demonstrate the depth of your gratitude? Johnny Erickson Tata knows what she would personally give up. She once said that I would rather be in this chair knowing him than out of it without him. That's an incredible thing to say. The Apostle Paul knows what he would give up as well. In chapter 3 of his letter to the church in Philippi, he writes, "I have suffered the loss of all things, and I count them rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him." Paul is willing to give up all of his past, everything that he has built his life upon, all of his works, simply for the sake of knowing Christ. You see, we become extravagant in our faith when we finally realize the magnitude of what Jesus has done for us, and in gratitude, we seek to give back. Pastor Victor Shepherd repeats a story that he heard several years ago from a missionary surgeon from the Gaza Strip. One day, the surgeon had stopped at a peasant hovel to see a woman upon whom he had performed surgery earlier to see how her recovery was going. She and her husband were just absolutely dirt poor. Their livestock supply consisted of one Angora rabbit and 2 chickens. For income, the woman would comb the hair out of the rabbit, spin the hair into yarn, and then she would sell it. For food, she and her husband would eat the eggs from the chickens. The woman insisted, grateful for all the surgeon had done, that he stay for lunch. And so he accepted the invitation and said he'd be back to eat with them after he'd gone down the road to see another post-operative patient. An hour and a half later, he was back. And with no one in the room, he peeked into the cooking pot to see what the meal was going to be. And there he saw 1 rabbit and 2 chickens. The woman had given up her entire livestock supply, their income, their food, everything. And as he told the story, he wept openly. You see, we become extravagant in our faith when we finally realize the magnitude of what Jesus has done for us as well. We've probably never seen a period of time that was as difficult, at least during my lifetime, as the Great Depression. Countless men and women lost their jobs and had no way to support their families. Several years ago, Susan's grandfather told me a story of how he was trying to eke out a living and care for his family during the Great Depression. Some of the automakers in Northwest Ohio and Southern Michigan would sometimes hire day laborers, and so he and his brother-in-law next door would sometimes head up to, just across the border to one of the factories and wait in a line outside. And he mentioned that one day a foreman came out and said, "We're looking for some welders going to be welding." And her grandfather's hand just kind of shot up really quickly, and he grabbed his brother-in-law, and they walked up to the front of the line, and they got hired that day, and they began to join the assembly line and begin to weld, and the foreman came over and watched them weld for a while, and said, "You know, you guys really aren't welders, are you?" And they said, "No, we're really not." And he said, "Well, you can finish out the work today, but you're not going to be able to return to the line tomorrow." It was just a really difficult period of time. And in Kilgore, Texas, things were no better. The Krim family in Kilgore owned the general store where everybody shopped in that town. And out of necessity, as the Depression continued, they began extending credit, which proved to be a mixed blessing. On the one hand, the folks could still buy their groceries, but in so doing, they just went deeper and deeper and deeper into debt. And then, 3 days after Christmas in 1932, oil was discovered on the Krim property, actually on Lou Della, on Mama Krim's in her front yard. And just like that, the Krims were wealthy beyond their wildest imagination. And being good Presbyterians, they wondered what they could possibly do to thank God for their great blessing. They'd always been faithful and generous in their support of the church, but you know, this was different. This was really big. And so the family huddled and they made a decision. They sent word to all of their customers asking them to come to the store at 8 o'clock on Saturday morning for an important meeting. And the customers, not knowing what the meeting was about and knowing full well how much they owed the Krims, braced for the worst possible news, the possibility that the Krims might be preparing to seize their property. By 8 o'clock Saturday morning, practically the whole town of Kilgore was milling around in front of the Krim General Store. And Malcolm Krim, the oldest boy from Lou Della's family, came out and stood on the front porch. A hush fell over the crowd. In his hand, he held the box containing the cards of all of the customers detailing what they owed. It didn't look very good. He spoke clearly and to the point. Oil, he said, had been discovered on their land. Prosperity had come to Kilgore. And as of that moment, all of their debts were canceled. And can't you just imagine the rejoicing and the celebration? You see, we become extravagant in our faith when we finally realize how richly God has blessed us and what Jesus has done for us. George Mackey Brown writes that there is something profoundly embarrassing about Mary's behavior, something wasteful, something awkward for us. This is a display Mary's wild love for Jesus. And then he writes, "To lose one's will in the will of God should be the true occupation of everyone's time on earth, but only a few of us, the saints, are capable of that simplicity." Maybe it's John Cosin writing in the 17th century who best captures what it is that we're invited to do in response to God's gift to us, as he offers this prayer from his collection of private devotions. "Lord Jesus," he prays, "I give thee my body, my soul, my substance, my flame, my friends, my liberty, and my life. Dispose of me and of all that is mine as it seemeth best to thee, and to the glory of thy blessed name." You see, we become extravagant. We become extravagant in our own faith when we finally realize the magnitude of what God has already given us in Christ. Amen. And will you pray with me? Oh God, as we continue our journey through this Lenten season, remind us again of the incredible sacrifice that you have undertaken on each one of our behalves, that out of love for us, you stepped into this world to reclaim us and to welcome us back home. Receive us into your arms and make us new again. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. And amen. Thank you, Con.
If you'd like to know more about this God whose love for us just overflows our lives in abundance, reach out to us. Send us a text or an email to journey@evangelium.org, and we'll help you in that pathway. And now receive the blessing. Go in peace, and may God's love for you so flow into and overfill your lives that you might live extravagantly before all, bringing hope and healing to all you meet. Go in peace. Amen.